So in the last class, we have talked about the different types of op-amp circuits, more specifically the different applications of op-amp circuits, like op-amp as an amplifier, I mean a summing amplifier, op-amp as a difference amplifier, then the voltage to current converter, current to voltage converter and all. Now in this class, I'll be specifically mentioning about one of the important applications of the difference amplifier. So in regard to this, let me once again revisit what we have discussed in the last class regarding a difference amplifier. So as you know, for a difference amplifier, we need to provide two different inputs, and these two inputs are applied at two different terminals, one at the inverting terminal and the second one at the non-inverting terminal. So the circuit was something like that. And in fact, this difference amplifier will form the backbone of several other important amplifiers, like instrumentation amplifiers and bridge amplifiers. So it would be better to discuss this issue of difference amplifier in much more detail. So you have an op-amp like this with two terminals, two input terminals. And two input signal was applied, one at the inverting terminal with some resistive feedback network. That is output terminal V0. And the second input was applied at the non-inverting terminal. Through another resistive feedback network. So it was like, so if I call this to be say V1, this to be say V2, and suppose these resistance are identified by R1, R2, R3 and R4, then actually what we have seen last day, that this V0 can be expressed as a weighted summation of two different input. And in fact, the weights associated with V1 and the weight associated with V2, they are having opposite polarity. So that's why we have called that particular amplifier as a difference amplifier, because unlike a summing amplifier, the corresponding weights are not having same polarity. However, if we can maintain a particular condition for the balance beat, that is R1 upon R2 is equal to R3 upon R4. If this condition is satisfied, that means the ratio of these two resistance is equal to the ratio of these two resistance, then what we have found is this output voltage VO can be written as a true difference of the two inputs, like R1 into V2 minus V1. So only under the condition that R1 upon R2 is equal to R3 upon R4, and assuming that the op-amp that we are considering here is an ideal one, then only the output voltage can be written as the true difference of the two inputs. Like we have two inputs, V2 applied at the positive terminal, that means at the non-inverting terminal, and V1 applied at the inverting terminal, then their true difference is V2 minus V1, and then the output can be written as R2 upon R1 into V2 minus V1. That is a true difference of the two inputs. Now that we have discussed already in the last class, but still this particular discussion is having some serious implication. Now sometimes in some of the applications, it is required to magnify the difference of the two inputs rather than the absolute value of the input. So here we have considered two different inputs like V1 and V2, and some application requires that the difference of the two inputs needs to be multiplied or needs to be magnified. And for which case, this difference amplifier is the perfect candidate. So the characteristics of the difference amplifier can be better appreciated if we can represent these two input from a different perspective. So what we have seen is these two inputs are different. One is V1 applied at the inverting terminal. Second one is V2 applied at the non-inverting terminal. And what we found is the output can be written as some product multiplied with the difference of the two inputs. Now that difference, this V2 minus V1, now that difference can be regarded as the differential component of the input. So we may call this to be the differential component. So we may call this is the differential component of the input signal. That is equal to V2 minus V1. That means your output signal or output voltage can be written as the amplified version of the differential component of the input signal. Now you have to represent each of the individual inputs like V1 and V2 as some constant component and the differential component. Now, depending upon the polarity, we can define the two inputs separately. Now, for this particular purpose, we have to define what is meant by the average component, or which is known as the common mode component of the input signal. And this common mode component of the input signal is written as, if I call it to be VCM, then that is nothing but the simple average of the two inputs, that is V1 plus V2 by 2. So now we may visualize that each of the inputs V1 and V2 can be written as the summation of the two different input or two different input component. So how can we write this? So we may write V1 to be VCM minus VDM by 2 and V2 to be VCM plus VDM by 2. That means we are dividing or we are representing the individual inputs like V1 and V2 as a summation of two different input components. So you may always regard this minus as an opposite of summation, because we can also think that whenever we are writing like VCM minus VDM by 2, that means we are adding VDM by 2 with VCM, but in opposite polarity. And that is the addition VCM plus VDM by 2 in case of V2 in the same polarity, in same phase. So basically, each of these inputs, V1 and V2, they are having some average component, which we call in the literature a common mode component of the input signal. And there is some small signal excursion over and above this average component. So we can think that suppose this is the common mode component, suppose this is fixed. So this common mode component is fixed, which we can regard like VCM. So we may call this to be a VCM. And over and above this VCM, I can have a VDM by 2 fluctuation like this. So this will give me what is known as V1. Similarly, we can also represent V2 considering the same VCM. Both of them are riding on a same common mode level, that is the average level. And here the excursion is just the opposite, because if you just notice the sign over here, minus and plus, then this will be the excursion. And remember, this difference, we may consider So at any point of time, you can think that. So V1 is equal to VCM minus VDM by 2. So VDM by 2 is basically the small signal that has been imposed over here. So you may think that this excursion from VCM to the peak can be regarded as plus VDM by 2, peak of that. And here the sign is just the opposite, the reverse one. Now, what does this particular defined amplifier do? If I assume that this particular condition of balanced bridge is satisfied and the op amp is ideal, then I find that the output voltage is equal to the amplified version of the differential component of the input signal. So although each of these two inputs, in fact, this is V2, this one is V2, as we are talking about, this one is V2. And we can think that, okay, this is the VDM by 2, so the total one is VDM, peak to peak. Here also, the same excursion. This one is like VDM. And this level is VCM. This level is VCM. So what you find is the output voltage can be written as the amplification of the differential component. So although both of these two inputs carry some non-zero VCM value, so we find that, okay, VCM is having some non-zero value, might be 3 volt, 4 volt, or whatever it may be, but that is not reflected in the output. So output can only extract the differential component of the input signal. So we can regard, or we can consider this V0 as R2 by R1, that is the gain of the circuit, multiplied with the differential component of the input signal. In fact, that calculation, what we have done right now, that we can also show, I mean, the dividing the input signal into two different components, like VCM and VDM by 2, can also be shown while applying the two inputs. So now what we can do is, we can have a common input signal, that is VCM, and then we do have two other components like VDM by 2 and minus VDM by 2. Let me just complete the structure first. So you have a resistive network over here. So now let us assume that, okay, let me use a different color for this one. Let me assume that this part is positive, this part is negative, and that is equal to VCM, which is common to both of these two. And here you have minus plus and another minus plus, and that is equal to VDM by 2. And here you find plus minus. Minus plus plus minus, the same magnitude VDM by 2. Let me consider, okay, the resistances being the same, R1 R2, here also R1 R2. Otherwise, the ratios had to be maintained properly. Now, for the sake of simplicity, I'm assuming that both of them are having the same resistance value, and we are taking the output from this terminal. So, what about the potential at this point? At this point, if you travel from ground, you have a minus 2 plus VCM, and then plus 2 minus VDM by 2. So VCM minus VDM by 2. So that was V1 applied at the inverting terminal of the op amp. And here, minus 2 plus VCM and minus 2 plus VDM by 2. So this potential is basically V2. So in fact, we have started with describing that the two defined inputs like V1 and V2 applied to the inverting and the non-inverting terminals of the op amp respectively through the resistance R1, R2, and R3, R4. Now that can be also accomplished, or that can be also shown by means of this diagram, where the input signal has been divided into two different components. One is the common mode component, second one is the differential mode component. Now, if the differential mode component is made zero, that means if these two different component like VDM by 2 and minus VDM by 2, if these two are made inactive, that means if you can just make a short circuit from this terminal to this terminal, and from this terminal to this terminal, that means out of these three different voltage source, if we just make these two source inactive, this VDM by 2 and this VDM by 2, then what we're applying is simply VCM, the common mode signal. And the same signal is being applied to the inverting terminal as well as to the non-inverting terminal of the op amp. Now, because of its nature of this defense amplifier, you find that both V1 and V2 that time is having the same value, because the difference occurs because of the presence of this minus VDM by 2 and plus VDM by 2. Now, if we make them inactive, if we make a short circuit connection from this terminal to this terminal and from this terminal to this terminal, then basically what you're applying is VCM, the common mode signal. And assuming that these ratios are maintained properly, that means R1, R2 here, and the op amp is ideal, then you find that the output signal will be zero, irrespective of the polarity of the VCM. So VCM could have been positive, VCM could have been negative, non-zero VCM, but as long as this VDM is absent, you find that V0 will be zero. So the output voltage will be zero for an ideal op amp. Sometimes it can also serve as a measure to test how far the op amp circuit is, or how far the op amp is ideal, how far the practical op amp is ideal. That means if you make these two point short circuited from this point to this point and this point to this point, that means if you apply the same input signal to each of the two different terminals, the negative and the positive terminals, then lower the value of V0 or closer the V0 to zero, better is the, or higher is the ideality of the op amp, assuming that these resistances are maintained in the proper proportion. Now, you must argue that what is the need of breaking, or what is the need of dividing the input signal by means of these two different components? So what you understand is this individual input signal like V1 and V2, so they are riding on a high DC level or common mode level, so which we regard like VCM. And over and above this VCM, there is a small fluctuation of the input signal. So although I have shown like a sinusoidal fluctuation, but the fluctuation could have been anything. For example, I can make a change. So instead of showing a sinusoidal variation, which sometimes can have some different or wrong implication that this fluctuation is always sinusoidal, not the case. That level is very large. Let me call this VCM value is like 2 volt or 2.5 volt. And over and above this 2.5 volt, suppose there is a small signal fluctuation. Suppose that could have been the transducer output. So whenever we are talking about any transducer in any application, so this transducer is providing some small signal fluctuation over and above some DC level. Now that could have been like, suppose this fluctuation looks something like that. So it contains some necessary information, although it looks like a random one, but it contains some necessary information taken from any transducer. Now sometimes it is required to magnify this part only. That means the small signal part only. So we don't require to magnify this average component. We want to extract the differential component, which is basically the useful signal. that useful signal is riding on a DC level, and we would like to magnify that signal or amplify that signal. So in order to do that, first of all, we have to extract this differential signal from the composite signal. So the composite signal contains both the common mode component, that means the DC level, this DCM, plus the differential one, the small signal one. Now we have to extract this. And sometimes the magnitude of this small signal component is much, much small as compared to the DC level, as compared to the common mode level or common mode value. So we can regard, we can call this situation to be like a high common mode environment. That means that value could have been in the range of, say, few volts. The VCM could have been like 1 volt or 2 volt. And over and above this 1 volt and 2 volt, suppose the signal, the useful signal, the sensory signal is in the order of, say, few millivolts. So that means thousands times less. So we have to extract that one. We have to extract this small sensory signal under a high common mode environment. And then we have to amplify this through some amplifier. Now you must appreciate that that is basically a challenging task. We have to extract this small signal whose magnitude is very small with respect to the level on which it is riding. And first of all, you have to extract that signal from this common mode environment, high common mode environment, and then you have to multiply this, I mean, magnify this one, amplify this one. Now, in order to accomplish that particular task, the natural amplifier, the normal amplifier, which we probably encounter in many of the applications, may not be a good choice. In regard to that, these different type of amplifiers, so these different type of amplifiers are the natural candidates to meet up that particular challenge. So that's why in many of the applications which deals with small signal transducer data, then this defense amplifier is having serious implication. Now before moving further, let me just tell you another thing, another important aspect of this defense amplifier. That means we are basically applying, or we are basically observing the output from two different perspectives. One is while we are applying the common mode signal, that means the same signal, same DC level we are applying to each of the inputs. And then what we have found is the output ideally should be zero. And the second one, which is known to be the differential mode operation. So in fact, this difference amplifier is having two different modes of operations. This V1 can be written as VCM minus VDM by 2, and V2 can be written as VCM plus VDM by 2. So by following the notion of superposition, so we can apply VCM first, and let us try to check what is the output, and then you apply VDM by 2. And then you do this calculation, plus or minus, depending upon the polarity. Now, as far as the superposition theorem holds good, so obviously the overall output, because of both V1 and V2, can be regarded as the output because of VCM plus or minus the output because of VDM by 2. So basically, there are two different modes of operation. One is known as the common mode operation, and second one is known as the differential mode operation. So for common mode operation, let me just tell you, perhaps you have already understood that during the common mode operation, the output voltage ideally should be zero. But apart from the output voltage, we are also interested in knowing the input impedance or input resistance experienced by the source. So for common mode operation, so these two terminals are shorted together. So in fact, you have a short circuited connection like this. And it looks something like that. Once again, I'm assuming that these resistances are made to be same. R1, R2, and R1 and R2. So this is the common mode operation. So that one is R1, R2, R1, R2. And we are applying the signal over here. So some common mode signal is applied with respect to ground. So this is output voltage, VO. So now this is the common mode operation. So let me just write it down. This is the common mode operation, and you must expect that the output should be zero ideally. Now we are interested in knowing the input impedance as experienced by the signal source itself. So basically, you have connected a signal source over here. You have connected some signal source over here between these two terminals, whose value is equal to VCM. That value is equal to VCM. And suppose the current being drawn by this inter network, let it be I. Then obviously, the corresponding value of the input resistance can be written as VCM by I. This VCM, the signal source, is providing a voltage of VCM, and the circuit draws a current of amount I. So obviously, the resistance as perceived by the signal source is given by VCM upon I. So now we have to find out what should be the value of I. Now you must be knowing that there is a virtual ground concept. So obviously, the potential over here at the negative terminal, at the non-inverting terminal, and at the inverting terminal must be the same. And since we have considered, if I consider that potential and this potential, so that potential difference and this potential difference being the same, and we are having the same value of the resistance R1 and R2. So therefore, the current will be shared equally by these two branches. So there will be a division of current at this particular node, and this current will be shared equally. So if I is the total current, then I by 2 will be flowing through this path, and rest I by 2 will be flowing through this path. Now you can find out what is the relation between this I and VCM. So this I by 2 is flowing through this path. Then obviously this will be flowing through this R1 and through this R2. So what will be the voltage drop? I by 2 into R1 plus R2, and that must be equal to VCM. So from that, you can find out the resistance or impedance under common mode is equal to. So I by 2 into R1 plus R2, that is equal to VCM. So VCM by I is equal to R1 plus R2 by 2. R1 plus R2 by 2. In fact, that value is finite. Now, let us move to the second configuration or the second operation, second mode of operation, which is known to be the differential mode operation. Now, in case of a differential mode operation, you will be applying two defined inputs. Like the excursion will be the opposite. So here, the excursion is just the opposite. So this is the circuit for differential mode operation. We have the same set of resistance like R1, R2, and R1 and R2. This is the output voltage, VO. And we are applying some VDM by 2 over here, some differential voltage. It can be anything. It can be VX, anything. So let me call VDM by 2. VDM by 2. Plus this side, minus this side. So now we have to calculate what should be the impedance as perceived by this particular signal source. So VDM by 2 is the corresponding input voltage which are being applied. So as you understand, plus VDM by 2 is applied here and minus VDM by 2 is applied at the negative terminal. So there is a phase reversal of 180 degree. So they are operating in the differential mode. So this is known to be the differential mode operation. This is known to be the differential mode operation. So here, the signals are different. That means whenever at this end, when the signal is having a form like this, during this time, at this end, when the signal is having a form like this, during the same time, here, the fluctuation looks like this, assuming that this peak-to-peak variation being the same. So that's why the name, the differential mode. However, here you find that the same value. Even if you vary the VCM, so that is going to affect both of these two terminals equally. So now, if you would like to find out the impedance here, suppose the current being drawn is I. So the same current will be flowing through this R1, through this signal source and through this R1. And here we assume that the potential at this end and the potential at this end being the same, because there is a virtual ground concept. So the current I multiplied with R1, I multiplied with R1, that is twice I multiplied with R1, must be equal to the signal source, that is VDM by 2. So if you'd like to find out the input resistance under this differential mode of operation, that is simply written as this input signal in this input voltage divided by the current. So the total resistance as perceived by the signal source under this differential mode of operation, which we can regard like RID, so that can be written as 2 times R1. However, both of these two are finite. As long as these resistances R1, R2, R3, and R4 used in the circuit are finite, so each of the input impedance, input resistance for common mode operation as well as for the differential mode operation will be finite. And because of the finite input impedance, this particular difference amplifier circuit is going to load the input signal source. So that is one of the serious disadvantage of this difference amplifier circuit. So now, before moving further, let me just tell you one important aspect of this difference amplifier circuit. So far we have assumed that this difference signal or difference, the differential component of the input signal, this VDM, can be extracted from the output terminal if and only if the op amp is ideal and if the resistances are maintained, are kept in the proper ratios. That means if this condition holds good, then accordingly we have shown like R1, R2, R1 and R2, assuming that these two resistances are having the same value and these two resistances are also having the same value. But sometimes the resistance, the value of the resistance may not be the same. So let us assume that out of these four resistance, let me assume that this resistance, this upper resistance is not having value of R2, rather it deviates from R2. And then obviously, then the circuit, even if the op amp is ideal, then it can also produce some output signal because of the common mode component, and obviously some output signal definitely for the differential mode component. As long as they are like R1, R2 and R1 and R2 and the op amp is ideal, then the output will be generated because of the differential mode component only and the common mode response will be zero. However, if there is some mismatch in the value of the resistance, then obviously it is going to affect the performance of the circuit. Now let us try to investigate what happens under this condition. So let me just show you the circuit first. In fact, we have to develop the same circuit that we have shown so far. So this is the resistive network. So this is the resistive network. And here you find another resistive network. But now the resistances are not in the proper ratios. So let me just show. So as you understand, this should be positive, this is negative. So we're applying PCM here. And here you have, this should be minus, it should be plus. This is VDM by 2. And here it should be the opposite. So this is VDM by 2. Polarity is different. Suppose this one is R1, this one is also R1. This one is R2. But instead of having R2 over here, suppose it deviates. It's not R2, rather R2 into 1 minus some epsilon, where epsilon is very small. And this is the output voltage, VO. So epsilon is the imbalancing factor. So epsilon is equal to 0 means perfect balance. Perfect balance. And epsilon not equal to 0 means imbalance. That means the condition will not be satisfied. And you cannot write the output voltage as the amplified version of the true difference. So you cannot write V0 as some constant multiplied with V2 minus V1. So that is not possible. That means you cannot generate the differential mode component only. Or in other words, this particular circuit will also develop some common mode response. So first of all, you have to represent this output signal, overall output signal, as a summation of the individual outputs. That means whenever this V1 is applied, what should be the output? And whenever the V2 is applied, what should be the output? In fact, we have derived such an expression already in the last year, but with the resistance imbalance. So first of all, suppose here the input, as you know, this input is V1 and this input is V2. And we have written V1 as VCM minus VDM by 2. And V2 is equal to VCM plus VDM by 2. Now, whenever we are trying to find out the output because of V1 only, then V2 should be kept inactive. So under this condition, this output voltage can be written as the output resulting from an inverting amplifier. The inverting amplifier with a resistance of R2 into 1 minus epsilon and R1. So assuming that this is inactive, so V2 is absent. So it's a simple inverting amplifier with a gain of minus this R2 into 1 minus epsilon by R1. So then this will be minus R2 into 1 minus epsilon upon R1 and multiplied to the input signal. So here the input is V1. So that V1 can be written like VCM minus VDM by 2. So that is because of V1 only, which we regard as VO1 last day. And then comes the second component because of V2 when V1 is absent. In that case, if V2 is the signal over here, so what will be the signal at this particular point? This is nothing but R2 upon R1 plus R2 into V2. And then you have 1 plus this one, R2 into 1 minus epsilon by R1. So this one is nothing but R1 plus R2 into 1 minus epsilon by R1. That is the gain of the non-inverting amplifier, 1 plus R2 into 1 minus epsilon by R1. That is the gain multiplied with this ratio, R2 upon R1 plus R2. And it gets multiplied with V2, where V2 is VCM plus VDM by 2. So now that is the composite expression for the output voltage. Now we can also regard, since this input signal is having two different components like V1 and V2. Similarly, we can also think that since the V1 and V2 consists of the common mode component and the differential mode component, therefore, we can also visualize the output as the magnified output because of VCM plus the magnified output because of VDM by 2. That means this output voltage can be regarded as some gain corresponding to the common mode component, which we regard like ACM into VCM plus ADM into VDM. So ACM is the gain because of the count mode component, due to the count mode component, and ADM is the gain due to the differential mode component. Now we can readily understand that since this proper condition, I mean the resistances are not kept in the proper condition, since there is an imbalance because epsilon is not equal to zero. So now ACM will be non-zero. Otherwise, ACM should be zero. If you put epsilon is equal to zero here, then you find that ACM should be equal to zero. So that means there is no component which can multiply VCM over here. But since there is a non-zero epsilon, so obviously there is a non-zero ACM. So we have to calculate this one. So what we can do is we have to write once again that expression. In fact, that expression, let me write once again V naught, that is equal to, we have minus R2 into 1 minus epsilon. So it's a big expression. So we need to do this calculation first by R1 into VCM minus VDM by 2 and plus you have the gain for the non-inverting amplifier, that is R1 plus R2 into 1 minus epsilon into R1 into R2 by R1 plus R2 into VCM plus VDM by 2. So now, if I would like to take VCM common, if I take VCM common, then what we have? So we can take this R2 by R1 common. We have R2 by R1 here also and here also. So what is left? You have like R1 plus R2 into 1 minus epsilon by R1 plus R2, that part minus, you have only 1 minus epsilon. And then for a VDM by 2, we can write like, okay, so I think it will be better if I write in the next line. Plus you have VDM by 2 now for VDM by 2, you have like R2 by R1, R1 plus R2 into 1 minus epsilon, the same expression, divided by R1 plus R2. Now instead of minus, you have now plus 1 minus epsilon. So this entire thing is your ACM. This entire thing is ACM, which you have to simplify. And this entire thing is ADM. In fact, as far as our notion is concerned, it should be twice ADM rather. It should be twice ADM because we have represented V0 as ACM into VCM plus ADM into VDM. So let us calculate what is ACM, the common mode gain. So it was like R2 by R1. And then we have like R1 plus R2 into 1 minus epsilon. R1 plus R2 into 1 minus epsilon. R1 plus R2 into 1 minus epsilon. Divided by R1 plus R2 minus 1 minus epsilon. So it will give me R2 upon R1. Then in the numerator you have something, and the denominator you have R1 plus R2. Then you have R1 plus R2 minus epsilon R2, and then you have minus R1 minus R2 plus epsilon R1 plus epsilon R2. So that gets simplified to R2 by R1 into, so R1 and R2 gets cancelled. Epsilon R2 also gets cancelled. So you have epsilon R1 only in the numerator, and in the denominator you have R1 plus R2. So that is equal to epsilon R2 upon R1 plus R2. So that is the expression for SEN. So as you can understand clearly that if the value of epsilon was zero for a perfect balance case, then obviously the SEM should be zero. Otherwise, epsilon, if epsilon is non-zero, then obviously the common mode gain would be non-zero. And in fact, we should expect that the value of epsilon should be small. With respect to one, it should be small, like 0.01 or 0.05, depending upon the amount or the magnitude of the imbalance. Now coming back to ADM, in fact rather to ADM, I'm just copying this from the second line. I'm just copying from the second line because otherwise everything will be same. You have R1 plus R2. So here you should have only plus over here. So R1 plus R2 minus epsilon R2. And since you have plus of 1 minus epsilon, so you have plus R1 plus R2 and then minus epsilon R1 and then minus epsilon R2. So then that can be simplified to be R2 by R1. Now we have R1 plus R2, R1 plus R2, so twice R1 plus R2. Twice R1 plus R2 minus epsilon R1 and twice epsilon R2. So if you take minus epsilon common, it should be R1 plus twice R2. And in the numerator, in the denominator, you have R1 plus R2. So now ADM can be written as, so it will be like R2 by R1. And then this will be cancelled, like 2. So 2 gets cancelled. So it will be 1 minus epsilon into R1 plus 2 R2 divided by R1 plus R2. So that will be the expression for ADM. Here also you can readily observe that if epsilon is equal to 0, then obviously the second term vanishes and you are left with R2 upon R1. So that was the differential mode gain what you have found. But since the value of epsilon is non-zero, so what we found is from the case of epsilon equal to 0, whenever you have some non-zero epsilon, when some imbalance exists in the circuit as far as the value of the resistance is concerned, so then the value of the common mode gain increases from 0 and value of the differential mode gain reduces from R2 by R1, because you have a negative sign over here, minus something. So the actual value should be R2 upon R1 when the resistances are maintained in the proper ratios. Now, since here you have some non-zero epsilon like 0.01 or 0.02, so obviously the value of ADM will be somewhat less than R2 upon R1, and the value of ACM would be somewhat higher than 0. So now, how can you just check, or how can you just judge the performance of any practical defined simplified circuit, whether the circuit performs good or not, that can be measured by means of a parameter which is known as the common mode rejection ratio. So what do you mean by the common mode rejection ratio? Here the purpose of the defined simplified circuit is to magnify or amplify the differential mode signal, and the here the operation is to reject, objective is to reject the common mode signal. The purpose of any true defined amplifier is to magnify the defined mode signal input component and reject the common mode component of the input signal. Now, how far the circuit is capable in rejecting the common mode signal, that can be visualized from a ratio that is nothing but ADM upon ACM. So that ratio serves as a very good purpose in identifying whether the circuit performs well in terms of rejecting the common mode signal, because the basic purpose here is to reject the common mode signal and amplify the defined signal. So that can be written, that can be observed by means of the ratio of these two gain, that is differential mode gain and the ratio of these two, ADM upon ACM. Ideally, this ADM should be finite, that is R2 upon R1, and ACM should be zero. So therefore, that particular parameter, in fact, we should put a modular sign over here, because we don't know what about the sign, depending on the value of the epsilon. So that ratio serves as a very good purpose to identify whether the intended operation can be performed well by the defined simplified circuit or not. Ideally, that ratio should be infinite, because it should be finite in the numerator and the denominator should be zero. So ideally, it should be infinite. Now, in order to represent this ratio in the decibel scale, what we do is we should put 20 log 10 base outside, because since, as you understand, since the value is very large, ideally I'm saying like ideally should be infinite, so it should be very large. So in order to deal with the large value, it will be better to represent them in the logarithm scale, so that that can be minimized in the log scale. So we should put 20 log 10 base ADM upon ACM, and that will give you what is known as, I have told you just now that it is known as it is a performance parameter, it's a performance metric. It's a performance metric which will show you whether the circuit is capable in rejecting the common mode component of the input signal, and this is known as common mode rejection ratio. Common mode rejection ratio, obviously in dB scale, or in short CMRR, in dB scale obviously. Now here you can put the value. You have already seen what about ADM and what about ACM. Now for the large value of, if you just compare here, the ADM was like R2 by R1 into 1 minus something, R1 plus twice R2 upon R1 plus R2. Now for a small value of epsilon, because that ratio R1 plus twice R2 and R1 plus R2, so that is almost comparable. So that ratio is almost comparable, this both the numerator and denominator. So this epsilon is there apart from this ratio. So that is normally very small with respect to 1, because the imbalance, percentage imbalance is not that large. So this ADM can be approximate. In fact, ideally it is, you can write like this. Ideally it is like R2 upon R1 into 1 minus epsilon R1 plus twice R2 divided by R1 plus R2. So that is the actual formula. But that can be approximated to simply R2 by R1, assuming that the differential mode gain is remaining almost the same. However, the common mode gain is rising beyond zero, and that value we have already seen, that is epsilon R2 upon R1 plus R2. So that is a matter of approximation. And if you put the value over here, you'll find that this common mode rejection ratio, this by this, is coming like 20 log 10 base. So R2 gets cancelled. So you have R1 plus R2 upon R1. So 1 plus R2 by R1 whole divided by epsilon. So that is the value of the common mode rejection ratio. Although that is an approximation, you can put the exact value. So what I can do is I can just put an approximation sign over here. So that can be approximated to 20 log 10 base 1 plus R2 by R1 divided by epsilon. Now, the defiance amplifier, which we have discussed for the last few minutes, or the last several minutes, forms the backbone of another important type of amplifiers in electronics. And that amplifier, which we fondly call as the instrumentation amplifier. Now, the instrumentation amplifier is having certain characteristics. And some of the characteristics can be readily extracted from the defiance amplifier itself, but there are still certain characteristics that cannot be readily extracted from the defiance amplifier directly, but we have to do some modification in the circuit so that these characteristics can be accomplished. Now, already I've seen that what is meant by the common mode rejection ratio. The purpose here, the sole purpose here is to enhance or magnify the defiance signal and reject the common mode signal. So the high value of this common mode rejection ratio is essentially a very important component for an instrumentation amplifier. In fact, the application of the instrumentation amplifier is to magnify the transducer output. And this transducer output is normally available in an environment with high common mode signal. So we have to reject the common mode signal and we have to extract the defiance signal. And then we have to magnify this one. So high CMRR you can easily achieve with a simple defiance amplifier, that is fine. And sometimes it is also required to have the gain to be stable and accurate, okay? That is great. You have to always require that for any amplifier, the gain should be stable. So there should not be any fluctuation with the gain. So that is also acceptable to some extent. But however, this instrumentation amplifier that we're talking about is having another requirement that cannot be readily provided by the typical defiance amplifier. And that is a very high value of the input impedance in the common mode and in the differential mode operation. So let me just go back to this slide where we have just calculated the value of the differential mode and the input and the common mode input impedance. We have found that for a typical defiance amplifier, the value of the input impedance in common mode environment is given by R1 plus R2 by 2. And in differential mode is equal to two times R1. So as long as this R1 and R2, they are finite in nature, so you cannot expect that this value is pretty large. So as a matter of fact, as I'm saying, that the purpose here is to magnify a small millivolt or microvolt signal in the presence of a high level of common mode signal. So it is always expected that the amplifier should not load the signal source, because as you know, whenever you are providing, for example, I'm just showing you very briefly that you know perhaps that I'm having a signal source like this, which can generate a signal Vs, which is having some source resistance, say RS, and it is connected to our to an amplifier. And suppose this amplifier is having an input impedance, say RI, so or RIN rather, and this is the source resistance of the signal source. So now it is always expected that the value of the RIN should be very, very large with respect to the resistance of the signal source, because if you just simply apply Ohm's law here, you'll find that the signal that gets coupled over here, if I call that signal to be say Vin, then you can readily show that this Vin can be written as RIN upon RS plus RIN times VS. Now we always expect that the signal that has been developed over here, so it can be the transducer output, that signal VS. Now that entire output should be fed to the input of any amplifier. That is always expected. But here you find that this Vin cannot be written as exactly equal to VS. Rather, there is a ratio that is equal to RIN upon RS plus RIN. Now, if the value of RIN is very large and if RS is very small, then that ratio can be considered to be equal to 1. And then you can write like Vin is approximately equal to VS. Otherwise, if this value of RS and RIN, if they are comparable, if they are in the same order, like RS is also in the range of few kilo ohms and RIN is also in the range of few kilo ohms, then obviously you don't expect that the entire signal which has been developed over here from the signal source will get coupled at the input of the amplifier. Suppose you are developing like say 10 millivolt signal, but suppose this RS and RIN, they are almost same. Under this condition, suppose if I assume that RS equal to RIN, then you find that only 50% of the signal will be coupled. So although it generates like a 10 millivolt small signal, then only 5 millivolt signal will get coupled at the input of the amplifier. And that is not a good sign of an amplifier. So it is always expected that the corresponding input impedance for a voltage amplifier should be as large as possible, so that this coupling loss can be minimized to some extent. However, if I just consider a typical difference amplifier, we have seen that it is like under both common mode and for difference mode operation, we have found that it is not that large. It is like simply R1 plus R2 by 2 and twice R1. So depending upon the value of R1, the value of this input impedance cannot be made very large. So obviously, you have to take a certain measure. And moreover, the output impedance of the amplifier can be made small, as small as possible. Ideally, it should be zero. That is fine. That can be expected. But that problem still persists, that the input impedance cannot be enhanced to a certain extent. Now, to take into that particular problem of difference amplifier into our consideration, the instrumentation amplifier has been formed in two different stages. So first stage is known as the input stage, and the second stage is known as the output stage. Now the input stage does not amplify, although it amplifies something, but in fact you find that the first stage or the input stage can be shown as a difference input difference output stage. And here, although providing certain amount of gain, the main purpose of the input stage is to provide a high input impedance to the signal source. That is the main purpose. Although the gain can be provided by both the input stage as well as the output stage, but the first stage or the input stage primarily provides a very high input impedance to the signal source. So that can be accomplished using three different operational amplifiers. In fact, the first two operational amplifiers will be there in the first stage or the input stage, and the third operational amplifier will do the fundamental difference operation. So the circuit is something like that. So here, so I'm just drawing the first stage of the different, I mean, this instrumentation amplifier. Now here, both the inputs applied at the non-inverting terminal. Both the inputs are applied at the non-inverting terminal. So let me call this to be the input which I am going to apply. And this is another input. That is fine. And then it works like a voltage buffer. So that means this voltage will be available . So it acts like a voltage buffer. Just need to draw the circuit. I think it should be a little bit. Let's see. So let us now concentrate first on this. So let me call this to be, say, resistance. Let it be, say, R dashed. This one, say, R double dashed. And this one, say, R dashed. And let me call this to be, say, VO1, and potential at this point to be, say, VO2. So what we find here is that by the input voltage, so okay, let me just mention the input voltage here. It was V1 and this one is V2. So it completes the first stage. Now the inputs are applied at the non-inverting terminal. So you must understand that by virtue of the property of the op-amp, so potential over here must be equal to V1 and potential over here must be equal to V2. So this potential must be equal to V1, this potential must be equal to V2. So across the resistance R double dashed, the potential difference is V1 minus V2. So what is the current flowing through this? It's nothing but V1 minus V2 divided by R double dashed, and the same current will also be flowing through this R dashed combination. That means there is a series path, and VO1. So let me just identify. So this is your V1. This potential equal to V2. So current through I. So that current. So if I call that current to be, say I dashed. So this I dashed is given by V1 minus V2 upon R double dashed. V1 minus V2 upon R double dashed. So that is the current which is flowing through R double dashed. And the same current is also flowing through R dashed and this R dashed. So therefore, here you find VO1 and VO2. These two defined potentials at the output of these two op-amps. So this VO1 minus VO2, if I just calculate this one, VO1 minus VO2, so that can be written like the current you have already measured. That current is V1 minus V2 divided by R double dashed. And it gets multiplied with R dashed plus R double dashed plus R dashed. So that can be written like V1 minus V2 into, so you have 1 plus 2 R dashed by R double dashed. So VO1 minus VO2 can be written as V1 minus V2 into 1 plus 2 R dashed by R double dashed. So this particular section, this particular stage accepts two input. One is V1, second one is V2. And it also provides two different outputs, because we have two different amplifiers, two different op amps. So obviously two outputs will be developed, but the difference between these two outputs can be written as the true difference of the actual inputs, like V1 and V2. And obviously there is a magnification. So what advantage you are getting out of that? The advantage is that because of the application of the two inputs at the non-inverting terminal, the corresponding, in fact, these op amps are acting as a voltage buffer. So you understand what is the implication of having a voltage buffer. It doesn't do anything regarding the, as far as the gain of the circuit is concerned. However, it provides a very high value of the input impedance. So that can be easily obtained with this particular architecture. However, we have to develop the final stage, and in case in the design of the final stage, obviously we should be having a single output. So here VO1 minus VO2 can be written as the difference between the two inputs multiplied with some gain. But ultimately, in the design of the instrumentation amplifier that we are talking about, there should be two inputs and a single output. So obviously, now these two input has to be fed as the two inputs of a true difference amplifier, which we have discussed few minutes back. So now you have the second stage, and here you have another op amp. Now this input will be applied at the non-inverting terminal of the op amp. And another input is going to be applied at the inverting terminal of the op amp. So this is the final output VO. And as mentioned previously, they must be having the same ratio. So I'm taking the same resistances here, for example, like R1, R2, and R1 and R2. So then you have found like two inputs, like VO1 and VO2. So one input over here, another input over here. So what will be the final output? So final output VO, we know that the expression for the final output, assuming that the op amp is ideal and the resistances are kept in the proper ratios. So it will be like R2 upon R1 into, so whatever the input. So these inputs are not V1 and V2, rather these inputs are VO1 and VO2. So we can write like VO1 minus VO2, the differential component of the input. And already we have proved that this VO1 minus VO2 can be written as a function of V1 minus V2. So ultimately, so if we now put the value over here, so it will be twice R dashed upon R double dashed. So first stage also provides some gain. And then you have this R2 upon R1, and then V1 minus V2. So then what he found is the output voltage, the overall output voltage can be written as, so there is a, this is the total gain. So that is the A, the total gain. So now V0 can be written as, and that gain is high enough, because you have the contribution from the two different stages. One stage serves the purpose of providing a very high input impedance, and although some gain is also being provided. And the second stage resembles of two differential amplifier, and then the final output voltage can be written as some gain multiplied with the difference of the two inputs. So now, so let me just write it down. What is the name of this amplifier? So this is known to be the instrumentation amplifier. Instrumentation amplifier. Now it serves the purpose of having a very high value of the input impedance, very low output impedance, obviously, because the final output is taken from this op amp. So if I call this is to be op amp number 1, this is to be op amp number 2, and this to op amp number 3. So the input, this is the first stage or in the input stage. So if I just emit this entire thing by means of a dotted box, then the input impedance is because of the impedances provided by op amp 1 and op amp 2, and the output impedance of this instrumentation amplifier is because of the impedance provided by the op amp 3. So here you have applied the input signal directly to the non-inverting terminal, so the input impedance is pretty large, and here the output impedance of this op amp, third op amp, will be small. So these specifications are clearly maintained, or these specifications can be achieved easily by virtue of the inclusion of the first stage. And second one is that the gain should be stable and it should be accurate. Now what you have seen here, the overall gain is a function of the defined resistances like R1, R2, R dash, and R double dash. Now you can, if you just select those resistance values very accurately, and then obviously the gain should be stable enough, because here you find that the gain is basically a function of the external resistance. So the op amp has nothing to do with that. So we can make it stable. And if I assume that these resistances are maintained in the proper ratios, in that case, the bridges are corresponding. Bridge is balanced, so there is no imbalance, and it can truly magnify or amplify the difference signal, that is V1 minus V2. However, if the op amp, this op amp, third op amp, suppose this is not ideal, so it can produce some output because of the count mode component of the input signal. Similarly, if the resistances are not maintained in the proper ratios, then also some common mode gain will be developed, that is ACM will be non-zero. But however, we find that the differential mode gain is large with respect to what we have seen last time. The last time the differential gain was R2 upon R1 only. This time the differential mode gain is a little bit higher by virtue of this particular factor. And therefore, this particular circuit provides a very high value of the common mode rejection ratio. So all these essential characteristics of the instrumentation amplifier can be obtained by means of this particular circuit. And you find this instrumentation amplifier very much popular in many of the applications where you find that you would like to magnify some transducer output, and that output might be obtained in a process control environment, might be in some biomedical applications where the transducer output is riding on a very high value of common mode signal. The actual transistor output is very small, but we would like to magnify this one, amplify this one through some amplifier. We have, first of all, we have to extract this one, extract the differential mode signal from a large common mode environment, and then you have to magnify this one. So to accomplish that particular task, and you know, to ensure that the amplifier should not load the input signal source, this instrumentation amplifier is a very good choice, and you'll find its widespread application in the field of test and measurement purpose. So that is why the name is like instrumentation amplifier, because you find its applications for the test and measurement instrumentation. So with this, I would like to conclude this lecture on the op-amp circuit.